The next item of business is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon on a COVID-19 update. The First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions, and I call on Nicola Sturgeon.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. At the outset of the statement today, I can confirm that there will be no immediate changes to the COVID levels of protection that currently apply to different parts of the country. However, I will provide a general update on the state of the pandemic, and of course I will address any question that members have. Firstly, though, let me report on today's statistics. Yesterday there was a total of 695 positive cases reported, which is 5% of the total number of tests, and the number of confirmed cases in Scotland now stands at 241,864. There are 121 people currently in hospital, which is one fewer than yesterday, and 12 people in intensive care, which is the same number as yesterday. I'm also pleased to report that no deaths were reported over the course of yesterday, which means that the total number of deaths registered under the daily definition remains 7,677. And once again, my deepest condolences go to all those who have lost a loved one. Let me turn now to the vaccination programme. It is now exactly 6 months since the first COVID vaccine was administered, and progress then has been remarkable. As of 7:30 this morning, 3,403,866 people across Scotland have received their first dose of the vaccine. That's an increase of 17,545 since yesterday. And most importantly, it means that almost exactly three quarters of the adult population in Scotland has now received a first dose of vaccine. In addition, 30,944 people received a second dose yesterday, and that brings the total number of second doses administered to 2,282,203. And that means more than half of the adult population is now fully vaccinated with two doses. These are significant, and I think they're really heartening milestones. And as ever, I want to thank everyone involved in delivering the vaccination programme across the country. Last week, the Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency approved the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine for use amongst 12 to 15-year-olds. That is also really good news, as it indicates that the vaccine, that particular vaccine, is safe for use in children of that age. The Scottish Government is now awaiting advice from the Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunisation on the vaccination of children in those age groups. I'm sure everybody will agree that it is vital that we continue to rely on expert advice in all of our vaccination decisions. However, vaccination may very well be a really important way of giving children greater protection, minimising any further disruption to schooling, and also further reducing community transmission of COVID. And so I can confirm that if the JCVI does recommend the use of the vaccine for children aged 12 and over, we will move as quickly as practically possible to implement their advice. For the moment, however, we continue to focus on vaccinating all adults as quickly as possible. This remains absolutely crucial in the race we are in between the virus and the vaccines. As today's figures show, case numbers in Scotland do continue to rise. In the last week, in fact, they have increased by approximately 50%. Over the past 7 days, there's been a net increase of 5,475 new cases. This is a rise from 3,728 in the 7 days prior to that. Now, this will partly be a consequence of restrictions easing. It's always the case, and we have always made this clear, that as we start interacting more, the virus does have more opportunities to spread. But the recent rise is also being driven by the more transmissible Delta variant, which now accounts for the majority of all new cases being reported. However, although cases are rising, the key question is the extent to which vaccination is weakening the link between the increase in new cases and an increase in serious health harms. We continue to assess this data very closely, and at this stage, it's important to be very clear. We remain optimistic that vaccination will allow us to move progressively to a less restrictive way of dealing with COVID. We already have evidence that two doses of vaccine does give protection against serious illness, even with the new Delta variant. And as I confirmed earlier, more than half of the adult population in Scotland has now had two doses. That includes more than 90% of people aged over 60 and more than 80% of those over 50. And of course, these are the age groups most at risk of falling seriously ill if they get the virus. As I indicated last week, it does appear that vaccination may be reducing the proportion of people who require hospital treatment as a result of COVID. At the start of the year, around 10% of new COVID cases were admitted to hospital. Over the course of May, that was 5%. That said, it's important that we continue to monitor this data so that the full impact of the Delta variant can be properly assessed. There's also encouraging evidence that the length of time people are spending in hospital is reducing. So taking all of that into account, and just as we all hoped, vaccination may well be giving us more scope to ease restrictions and therefore reduce the social, economic and wider health harms that the response to the virus so far has caused. However, while all of these signs are very positive indeed, there is of course a need for continued caution, especially while a significant proportion of the population has not yet had both doses and so remain more vulnerable to becoming ill and needing hospital treatment. The number of people in hospital may not be rising as quickly as the number of new cases, but even so, it has roughly doubled in the past month. If cases continue to rise, we will see that trend continue. And even though on average people may be spending less time in hospital, it's still the case that if you do end up in hospital because of COVID, the virus has made you seriously unwell. And of course, in some cases, those who suffer from long COVID, for example, you can be seriously ill without ever having to go to hospital. So in summary, our position is still fragile. Case numbers are higher than we would like. The virus does still cause serious health harm. And of course, it still has the potential to put pressure on our health service. That's why we must continue to assess the data carefully as we make decisions about whether and when to ease restrictions further. But on the upside, and I want to stress, I think it is a very significant upside, the vaccines do appear to be doing their jobs, and that should give us all firm grounds for optimism. And it is, of course, why our top priority and a key consideration in our future decisions remains the speed at which we can vaccinate people so that as many as possible get the added protection against serious illness as quickly as possible. Now, while it is the vaccines that are offering us real hope for the future, it remains the case that we all have a role to play in getting us back to normal. So I want to finish by reiterating the three key requests that are being made of all of us. Firstly, please do get tested regularly. Free lateral flow tests are available through the NHS Inform website so that you can take a test twice a week, and I strongly encourage everyone to do that. Taking a test tells us if we might have the virus, even if we don't have the symptoms of it. And of course, if you test positive, please make sure you self-isolate and get the lateral flow result confirmed through a PCR test. That is vitally important. The more we all do test, the more cases we can find and the more we can break chains of transmission. Secondly, make sure that you do get vaccinated when you're invited to do so, and please make sure you attend for both doses. If you need to rearrange an appointment, or if you think you should have had an invitation by now and want to check up on that, or if you're aged 18 to 29 and haven't yet registered for your appointment to make sure all your details are up to date, please go to the vaccination section of the NHS Inform website. Getting vaccinated is in our own best interest. Whatever age we are, it will make it less likely that we become seriously ill from COVID, but it also helps us protect each other. Getting vaccinated is likely to be the single most important thing most of us will do this year to protect our family, our friends and our neighbours. So please, when it is your turn, roll up your sleeve and get the jags. And finally, please continue to stick to the rules where you live and follow all of the public health advice. I know that this becomes more and more difficult as time goes on. And I also know that as restrictions ease bit by bit and we try to get back to normal, any apparent anomalies in the rules and advice can be frustrating. We are trying to strike the best and the most appropriate balance overall, but I readily concede that it is not perfect. However, there are some principles that we can and should all follow. Meet outdoors as much as possible. No environment is ever entirely risk-free in any sense, but in relation to COVID, meeting people outdoors does pose less risk than meeting indoors. If you are meeting indoors, though, please stick to the limits and make sure the room is as well ventilated as possible. And please continue to follow advice on physical distancing, hand washing and face coverings. All of us long to see the back of all of these mitigations, but for now, basic measures to prevent transmission are really important and effective against all variants of the virus. So in summary and conclusion, please get tested regularly, get vaccinated when you're asked to do so, and continue to follow the public health guidance. If we all do that, we will help keep the virus under control while the vaccination programme continues to do its work. And that will help keep ourselves and each other safe and maximise, I hope, the opportunity of a summer of fewer restrictions and much greater freedom.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 40 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. And it would be helpful if members who wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak buttons now. And I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Today is exactly 6 months since the first person here in Scotland and others across the United Kingdom began to be vaccinated against COVID-19. And I think it is a moment for us all to pause and reflect on the huge success of the vaccination programme and express our thanks to the NHS, the volunteers and the British Armed Forces, who have ensured that 75% of adults in Scotland are now protected with the first dose of the vaccine and 50% are protected with both doses. It's also encouraging that younger people may soon be able to safely get the COVID vaccine as well. And that's because the vaccination scheme is our route out of both the restrictions and this pandemic. So I hope that once the JCVI make their recommendations on the safety of this use for 12 to 15 year olds, we're able to make swift progress so that young people's education is not disrupted any further. Just last week, the First Minister outlined in her statement to Parliament, when she was announcing that many areas of Scotland would remain in level 2 rather than move to level 1 as they had expected, she said, and I quote, "We could still see a significant burden of illness and death and severe pressure on our NHS." Yet a week on, we've heard nothing from the First Minister or her government back up that claim. We are at a difficult point in this pandemic when we need the public on side with the restrictions they continue to live with. Yet we are not hearing from the government evidence to support very strong statements such as the significant burden of illness and death and severe pressure on the NHS. And this statement as a whole is telling for what it misses out and who it ignores. Nothing for people protesting outside the Parliament today about the restrictions of play centres. Nothing for venues confused why numbers for christenings are more limited than those for comedy shows. Nothing for couples frustrated that their wedding numbers had to be limited to just 50 at the last minute. And nothing for parents who want to be there in person to be with their young children as they graduate from nursery primary school. The First Minister referenced apparent anomalies in the rules, but she hasn't said anything about what she'll do about those, if anything. So can I ask the First Minister, will she explain to people and businesses who are left wondering why 6,000 people can attend a fan zone without mandatory testing, while the limits on weddings, christenings and hospitality in general remain so strict? Will she re-examine the limits on weddings and funerals for areas in level 2? What specific reasons are there for the ongoing restrictions to soft play centres who are currently protesting outside? And this is an answer I think they will listen to closely. And finally, will she agree to find a solution so that parents can see their young children graduate from nursery to primary school?
First Minister.
Second Officer, I'll do my best to address all of these points. But the one thing I would say in an overarching sense is none of this is easy. And these decisions, they require good quality clinical advice, but they also require judgment and the ability sometimes to make decisions that people don't want to hear, because this is really difficult, and to try to navigate our way through this in a way that shows as much leadership as possible. And that's what I'll continue to do, and continue to be accountable and to do my best to explain decisions to people across the country. On the issue of vaccination, we are already doing the planning to extend the vaccination programme to children over 12, should the JCVI recommend that. Of course, it's the MHRA that opines on the safety in on balance of the vaccination. The JCVI have got to look at the clinical implications of vaccination, the priorities in terms of order of the population versus the supply and other matters like that. We, all of us across the UK, all four nations, followed the JCVI advice, and it's right and proper that we do so. But in anticipation of the JCVI giving the go-ahead to vaccination of over 12s, we've already started that planning. And as I said in my statement, we will move to implement any such advice as quickly as possible. But it is important that we continue to follow clinical prioritisation. That's why we started with the frailest, oldest people and have worked our way down the age cohorts, making sure that those with underlying health conditions of whatever age they are get vaccinated as quickly as possible. In relation to the second point raised by Douglas Ross, which I have to say I kind of struggle to understand, but I'm going to do my best. I said last week, and I don't think there is a leader of any government anywhere in the UK or anywhere in the world who would say anything different. As we face rising cases again, and while we are still learning about the efficacy of the virus, it is the case that rising cases, particularly while we have a significant proportion of the population not fully vaccinated, rising cases could lead to a significant burden of illness, hospitalisation and death. The operative word there is could. Clearly, I don't want to ever be standing here bearing out that statement, because I really hope that doesn't happen. And what we do, Douglas Ross said he hasn't heard anything from the government since I made that statement last week. That's just factually wrong. We publish every single day the numbers who are in hospital and the numbers who are in intensive care and the numbers who are losing their life to this virus. So people can see on a daily basis what is happening in terms of the burden of hospitalisation, those needing intensive care and those dying from this illness. Now, in my view, one person losing their life is one too many, but we can see at this early stage a weakening of the link between rising cases and the burden of illness. But we have to be cautious, because it is too early to be absolutely definitive that this new variant won't change that dynamic. Secondly, even if we are seeing that link continue to break, as long as we still have a proportion of the population not fully vaccinated, a proportion of them ending up in hospital would still create a significant burden in our health service. So we have to look at this carefully. All of the evidence so far is positive, but it would be utterly irresponsible to deny the potential reality of the rise in cases we are seeing now causing that increased burden, and we monitor that and publish data on a daily basis. And you know, if Douglas Ross wants to listen to the Prime Minister and indeed to the Prime Minister's clinical advisers south of the border, I suspect he's more likely to listen to them than he is to listen to me. He will hear pretty much the same calculations and considerations underway as they have to make a decision next week about whether to go ahead with the next round of planned easing in England on the 21st of June. So we're all grappling with this, and to try to do it to the best of our ability takes that recognition and that attempt to show strong and clear leadership to people, which I think is incumbent actually on all leaders, not just those of us in government. In relation to soft play, the clinical advice that the government has had is that given the indoor environment, and there is a big difference between indoor and outdoor environments, but the indoor environment coupled with the particular characteristics of soft play mean that it continues to pose a risk. Of course, soft plays in level one areas can reopen, and we hope more parts of the country over the next few weeks will go to level one. The Finance Secretary set out an intention to continue to provide financial support in the meantime. I wish everywhere could open immediately, but I have a duty to try to do this in a way that keeps people as safe as possible. And that means continuing to consider things in the round. There will always be apparent anomalies. I wish there weren't, and we try to avoid that. But as we try bit by bit, step by step, to get the country back to normal, we have to make sure we are striking the right overall balance. It's not easy, I'm afraid, but it is necessary, and it's the job I am determined to continue to do.
Anna Sarwar.
I thank the First Minister for prior sight of her statement, and 6 months on from the first vaccine, can I thank our vaccinators and our volunteers for giving our country hope. While there are definitely signs of progress, the rise in cases and the increase in hospitalisations shows that we can't be complacent, and we must accelerate our response. Is the First Minister still intending to review the next stage of easing of the restrictions on the 28th of July? And if so, will she commit to an ambitious target of double dosing everyone aged over 40 and at least one dose for everyone aged over 18 by that date? Our target was 400,000 vaccinations a week. I want us to hit that target and go beyond that target to make that a reality. Can we also, in those areas where there is a high turnover rate in terms of property turnover and low attendance rate, can we ramp up opening of walk-in vaccination centres so people can access those vaccinations without requiring a letter, so we can continue to go forwards and not backwards? And on the issue of soft plays, I think it's really important that we maintain public trust throughout the response to this pandemic. And the way we do that is maintaining strong communications, but also a consistency of decision-making. So does she recognise why the soft play industry believe there is an inconsistency in decision-making, given what's happened south of the border and what's happening in Scotland? Will she agree to meet with them and to work with them so they can safely reopen their premises in Level 2, like other parts of the UK, so we can save jobs, protect Scotland's economy and get our country's mental health and wellbeing back on track?
First Minister.
I'll address most of those points. Can I just say, firstly, and I mean this really sincerely, last week at First Minister's Questions, Anna Sarwar, as he is entitled to do, posed a series of questions to me which criticised me for, in his words, it's not necessarily a characterisation I would accept, but in his words, simply following what was happening south of the border in an earlier stage of the pandemic. Now, he stands here and says, why am I not just doing exactly the same as south of the border? So we have to take decisions based on our own clinical advice that we think are right. What I do recognise is that people do see perceived inconsistencies. Sometimes they will be right, and we have amended things in the past with particular premises where it did appear to be genuinely inconsistent. Sometimes the inconsistency will be perceived because there is a good reason why soft play, for example, cannot open in level two while other things can. I absolutely accept there is a need to communicate that as clearly as possible, but I also accept if you're running a business that remains closed, that is always understandably going to be very difficult to accept, and I really do appreciate that. But the important thing here is trying to navigate our way through this as safely as possible. At every stage of this, it has been the case that if we simply opened up everything, we would be overwhelming our ability to cope. So we sometimes have to be limited in what we do, recognising that we have to continue. And Anna Sarwar was saying is work with people and compensate people, and I accept that, and we will continue to seek to do that. On the issues of vaccination, we are vaccinating as quickly as our supplies allow. I would love us to be doing more, but the constraining factor is the supply. So we are the latest seven-day rolling total number of new first and second doses is 343,548. We will get that above that if supplies allow. So that is what is limiting our speed of vaccination, but our speed of vaccination is very fast. So if you look at first doses, people over 60, pretty much 100%, 99-100% done. Over 50, 50 to 54, 93% done. 40 to 49, 86%. 30 to 39, 58%. Even in the 18 to 29-year-old age group, 27% have had their first doses. Over 50, 50% have had the second dose, are fully vaccinated. But again, in the younger age groups, 40 to 49, already 29% have had the second dose, 20% of 30 to 39-year-olds, and 14% of 18 to 29-year-olds. So we will speed that up as much as supplies allow us to do. And on the point of review, it's 28th of June that the next dosing is, and I know that was simply a slip, but just to be clear, 28th of June, and I will set out in Parliament on the 21st of June what our expectation is of going ahead or not, or to what extent we will go ahead, and that will be informed by the latest data. Between now and then, of course, as far and as quickly as supplies allow, we will be getting as many people as possible vaccinated, not just with one, but with two doses.
Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. The First Minister refers again, as she has in the past, to the race between the vaccine and the virus. I think it should be clear to us all by now that a global pandemic is the kind of race where we only win when everybody wins. We're only safe when everybody is safe. Does the First Minister therefore support the open letter that's been written by UNICEF and supporters to the leaders of the G7 about the global vaccination programme for developing countries? COVAX, they point out, is 190 million doses short of where it needs to be. And if developing countries with more limited health infrastructure get large numbers of vaccine doses late, that won't lead to mass vaccination. It will lead to mass wastage. So what response does the First Minister hope will come from the G7 leaders to this call for earlier, larger scale and more predictable donations of vaccine by rich countries to developing countries? And how can Scotland's voice be added to the call for greater ambition on the global aspects of this pandemic?
First Minister.
Yes, I do broadly support the terms of the UNICEF letter, and I hope to see coming out of the G7 an agreement that there is a real responsibility on the part of the G7 to help speed up vaccination, not just in the countries of the G7, but globally as well. And I will continue to add as loudly as I can Scotland's voice to that. I think in summary, Presiding Officer, we need to seek to do two things. Make sure that the supplies of the vaccine that are available in the world are as equitably as possible distributed. And I think we've got to avoid the risk of false choices being put before us. The supplies through the very good procurement that the UK has done mean that we shouldn't see this as a choice between, for example, vaccinating children and playing our part in helping global vaccination. But the second thing we need to do is support efforts to ramp up production of vaccinations in as many parts of the world as possible. It is absolutely the case that while, of course, we are really focused on vaccinating our own population as quickly as possible, because that is our first contribution to ending this global pandemic, we will not end the pandemic until the whole world manages to exit from it. And the best chance we have of exiting from it is through mass vaccination. So we've all got a part to play in that, and the richest countries in the world have a real moral obligation to lead that effort.
Call Willie Rennie.
It's carers week, but 72% of unpaid carers have not had a break since the pandemic began. Last week, I asked the First Minister to reopen day services for adults with special needs. In response, the relevant minister issued a new letter today, but with a link to the old guidance. So nothing has really changed in the last week. And it makes no difference what level you live in. The barriers to reopening are just the same. People are getting desperate. So will the government issue new guidance to give local authorities the clarity that they need to get these services open once again?
First Minister.
I understand the desire for that. I share the desire for that. I would simply, as I have done on previous occasions, ask Willie Rennie to accept that there is no minister in the government that is somehow standing in the way of that for any other reason than the clinical position will still be that we need to be cautious and take precautions. Yes, we will get to a position of issuing new guidance, more permissive guidance as quickly as possible. And I've said very clearly and repeat against today that we need to prioritise things like that. But nobody is trying to hold up moves like this for any other reason than trying to keep the most vulnerable in our society as safe as possible. But I'll make sure that the health ministers look again at this issue, given that it's been raised again, to see whether it is possible to speed that up, to go more quickly and to have more distinction between the different levels of protection that apply.
Thank you. I call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Annie Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. 16.1% of all jobs created in the UK last year through foreign direct investment were generated in Scotland, some 4,500. Remarkable in a pandemic year. Given that across the 12 nations and regions of the UK, Scotland has attracted the second highest number of overseas-backed investments after London in every year since 2014, does the First Minister agree it's time for unionist politicians to dispense with the scare stories about this government's commitment to independence deterring investment, desist from talking down Scotland and back the outward-looking, creative and innovative nation that Scotland is as we recover from COVID-19?
I would suggest perhaps that the member is straying beyond the bounds of this statement. If the First Minister has a relevant response to the statement that may help Mr Gibson.
I would say, Presiding Officer, with your permission, I think yesterday's EY Scotland Attractiveness Survey should be welcomed by everybody across the chamber, and we should actually bring ourselves to come together to welcome it, because what it does show is that in the face of a global pandemic, Scotland remained the top UK inward investment destination outside of London, and indeed that's been the case for 8 of the last 10 years. And we also managed to grow our inward investment at a time when it shrunk across the UK as a whole. So whatever our different political viewpoints, whatever our different ambitions for the country, surely in the face of this really tough time that we are facing as a country, we can all come together to welcome some thoroughly good news for the Scottish economy.
Thank you. I call Annie Wells. Annie Wells to be followed by Bob Doris.
Presiding Officer, recent figures showed that fewer than one in every 20 pupils in S3 to S6 took part in the COVID-19 testing programme, and for younger secondary pupils, uptake was just 6.3%. And worryingly, despite being in the grip of an outbreak, rates of asymptomatic testing in schools in Glasgow were the lowest in the country. Given recent warnings from public health experts that school children are driving the epidemic in Scotland, what action will the First Minister take to ensure that there is an adequate testing regime in place?
First Minister.
There is an adequate testing regime in place. All senior school pupils are able to access tests, and many do. And while we cannot mandate and force young people to take the tests, all of us, and I would include all members of this Parliament in our own constituencies, can encourage young people to do that. Like many other people across the chamber, I have family members in that age cohort that Annie Wells mentioned there. I know that for young people, taking a lateral flow, for any of us, taking a lateral flow test is not something we really want to have to do, but it is important because it helps to determine whether somebody might have the virus, even if they're shown no symptoms, and then all of the other protections can flow in behind that. So, you know, like many of this, I don't have a magic wand to make 100% of young people take these tests, but I will continue to encourage them to do so. They are available, they are easily available, and it really matters that people do. So I would ask Annie Wells and others across the chamber to echo that, to add their voices to that, and let's get uptake as high as we possibly can.
Bob Doris to be followed by Jackie Bailey.
Presiding Officer, I pay tribute to the work of NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde and Partners for the delivery of the vaccine programme in Glasgow. In recent days, I've been contacted by a small number of constituents who've approached me who have about to approach or pass their 12-week period for their second vaccination. I appreciate there will always be occasions where a small number of appointments don't run smoothly during any mass vaccination campaign, but can I ask the First Minister to work with NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde to ensure this does not become a particular issue in the city that I represent and that such instances are resolved quickly? And can I ask what information is available as to the efficacy of a second vaccination administered beyond 12 weeks?
First Minister.
This is a really important issue, and I want to start by giving an assurance that we do work closely with health boards on this issue. I think the first thing to say is that in line with the latest advice from the JCVI, where vaccine supplies allow, we are bringing forward, or health boards are bringing forward, the second dose of vaccine from 12 weeks to 8 weeks, and many of us will know people who've had their second dose accelerated to within that timescale. However, and Bob Doris is right to say, in a programme of this scale, there will always be small numbers that don't get what we want them to get or what we think they should have done. We are aware of a small percentage of the overall vaccinated population who've had to wait longer than 12 weeks for their second dose. For those whose second dose of the vaccine does run beyond the 12-week point, we encourage them to make contact with their local health board or attend one of the drop-in clinics that a number of local authorities are running. There will be a variety of reasons why that small number have not had their second dose within 12 weeks. But get in touch with your local health board, check through the NHS Inform website in order that that can be rectified. In response to the last part of Bob Doris's question, while we do want people to be vaccinated within 12 weeks and as far as supplies allow now within that 8-week timescale, it is important to note that receiving a second dose beyond 12 weeks doesn't pose any clinical risk, and therefore, if somebody goes beyond that 12 weeks, there's no need to recommence the whole vaccination cycle.
Thank you. Jackie Bailey, to be followed by Christine Graham.
Can I welcome the news that the Pfizer vaccine has been approved for use in children aged 12 to 15? The First Minister will know of the case of Katie Steele, a young girl with cerebral palsy. Katie missed all of her second year at school and has barely been in during this academic year. And she is not alone. Katie's life and her family's lives would be transformed if she got the vaccine. So subject to the JCVI decision, will the First Minister commit to vaccinating all children in the 12 to 15 age group before schools return in August, and specifically prioritise vulnerable young people like Katie?
First Minister.
I would absolutely love to stand here and give that commitment, and I know of Katie, and I know how important it is to her and indeed to her family and families of young people like her to get vaccinated as quickly as possible. I also know that people would agree that it should not be for me, with no clinical qualifications, to decide who gets vaccinated when. That's why expert advice is really important. There's a couple of issues that we have to await. First of those is the JCVI advice. They will advise on whether and in what order and to what extent we should commence the vaccination of children over the age of 12. But of course the other issue, which means that I cannot right now give that commitment in terms of the return of schools, is that the speed at which we will do that will be dependent on the supply of vaccine. At this stage, and I hope this is something that changes on the upside, but at this stage the MHRA advice is only for the Pfizer vaccine, so it is only that one manufacturer that at this stage would be available for that, and supplies are not limitless, so we don't yet know exactly what the supplies would be in order for us to set out exactly how long it will take to vaccinate that section of the population. It may be, and I don't know because I have to wait and see the JCVI advice, that just as with the adult population, they recommend an order of priority for children over the age of 12, and that may take account of underlying health conditions and other factors. But as soon as we have that advice, as soon as we have a clearer line of sight about supplies, we will inform Parliament of what our expectations are and what the likely timescale of any such extension is likely to be.
Thank you. Before I take the next member, I have much interest in the statement and a desire to ask questions from across the chamber. I'd be very grateful for shorter questions and responses, and I call Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll certainly try to comply. First Minister, can I ask if there will be a review of the vaccination status scheme? As I have constituents who are awaiting their second vaccination appointments, didn't receive these, logged on to check their own vaccination status to find out erroneously it had recorded they had been vaccinated a second time. So, and then they had to go through the helpline and all that. So can I ask if there's to be an assessment of the whole vaccination programme and if that can be taken into account? Minority though it is, it matters.
First Minister.
Matters. It will be a small minority, but every individual cares deeply about their ability to get vaccinated. NHS staff work to absolutely minimise any errors in recording and also work to rectify issues when they're identified. We are aware of some challenges that a small number of users have faced with the service, for example, where their first dose has been recorded twice in error, and where any cases like that are identified, the NHS works to resolve them as quickly as possible. We understand that even in cases where someone's first dose has been marked on the individual's record twice, this should not prevent an appointment for a second dose being generated. Of course, wider work is underway to ensure that records are accurate and amended in ways which are auditable and have clinical oversight. And of course, in due course, our focus right now is on vaccinating people, but in due course, we want to have a review of this first vaccination programme, because I suspect this will be a regular vaccination programme in the years ahead.
Donald Cameron, to be followed by Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you. Many cultural venues and festival organisers are understandably frustrated by the perceived inconsistency in physical distancing rules. In hospitality venues, people can be sat 1 metre from another without a face covering, but in cultural venues, people must keep 2 metres apart and wear a face covering. Will the First Minister commit to urgently reviewing this discrepancy, especially in light of the various summer festivals which are about to occur across Scotland?
First Minister.
I'm sure Donald Cameron is aware, because I'm pretty sure I said it during last week's statement, we are currently undertaking a general review of physical distancing, and we will set out the conclusions of that as soon as possible.
Joe Fitzpatrick, to be followed by Sarah Boyack.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. With COVID cases rising more steeply in some areas, including in parts of Tayside, can the First Minister advise what lessons have been learned from those areas that have recent experience of dealing with rising case numbers, such as Glasgow and Moray, and whether similar public health measures are being implemented and considered in my constituency in Dundee and neighbouring areas to tackle our concerning rise in case numbers?
First Minister.
Well, the incident management team is actively managing the situation in Tayside, and I'm grateful for their hard work. That includes deployment of mobile testing unit, targeted engagement through schools and community outreach, and of course the continued vaccination drive. There is, and I said this last week, there's a massive opportunity to share learning. To support this, the Scottish Government has developed an outbreak management toolkit for local authorities and other partners. That toolkit was shared last week. It includes practical material on enhanced testing, accelerated vaccination and a communications toolkit to support local messaging, and that draws on practical material shared by colleagues in Glasgow. Public Health Scotland continues to support lessons learned activity, and the National Incident Management Team provides regular opportunity for each of the 14 health boards to share experience too.
Sarah Boyack, to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
First Minister. First Minister, given that Edinburgh's incidence of COVID numbers is now overtaking Glasgow in terms of numbers per 100,000 over the last 7 days, when will walk-in clinics be available for people aged over 18 to access vaccines urgently? And what monitoring and testing is now being carried out across the city in workplaces, both in public and private sectors, and in our schools, so we can see urgent action when COVID transmission is identified to reduce its rapid spread throughout our city?
First Minister.
Well, the toolkit that I spoke about in my previous answer is available to NHS Lothian and to local authorities across the NHS Lothian area. They have plans in preparation for walk-in vaccination clinics and are also using testing as appropriate. Certainly during the Glasgow outbreak, or the height of the Glasgow outbreak, NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde communicated very effectively with local MSPs. I am one of those, of course, and I will ask the Health Secretary to ensure that NHS Lothian is doing likewise with local members, so that there is an understanding of all of the outbreak measures that are being taken to try to bring transmission back under control.
Stuart McMillan, to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a result of no food or beverages being sold at Hampden for the upcoming Euro 2020 matches, some fans will have to wait for up to 5 hours in between eating or drinking, and this may cause an issue, particularly for those with underlying health issues. Whilst it's understandable the decision was taken for health reasons, will fans be allowed to take food or beverages into Hampden for the 4 upcoming Euro 2020 matches?
First Minister.
Well, concession stands won't be in operation for the Euro 2020 matches at Hampden as a result of all of the mitigations that have had to be put in place. That's to ensure that physical distancing is possible on concourses when people are moving to and from their seats on entry and exit and when going to the toilet. However, spectators will be able to bring food with them into the stadium. I know discussions are ongoing between the Scottish FA and UEFA to reach an agreement on what will be in place with regard to drinks, and UEFA will confirm the situation with all ticket holders, and I'll make sure the member is updated when that has happened.
Graeme Simpson, to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've written to Kate Forbes asking for extra help for the travel industry, particularly travel agents, and I hope the First Minister will agree to look at that. But I want to ask about another issue concerning the industry. If someone travelled to a green list country from an English airport, they could book a testing package using multiple providers for £60. If they flew from a Scottish airport, the Scottish Government says they could only use one provider, CTM, and that same package would cost £195, and it's similar for amber countries. So what can the First Minister do to bring down the cost and stop Scots from being ripped off?
First Minister.
I'm not sure if it was Graeme Simpson, who asked this question a couple of weeks ago, my answer is the same. We continue to look at these things, but we want to make sure that we have assurance and can give assurance around the quality of the testing that is in place. Why the difference? In many respects, the UK government, and this is entirely up to them, choose to outsource more outside of the NHS than we decide to do in Scotland. We keep these things under review, but making sure that we have assurances around quality is really important, and I hope that most people would understand and accept that.
John Mason, to be followed by Martin Whitfield.
Thank you very much. Over the last year, we have looked at different numbers at different times, be that the R number, the ICU capacity, the hospital capacity, and sadly, deaths. Can the First Minister say anything about the next few weeks and months and which figures we'll really be focusing on?
First Minister.
We've always relied on a range of indicators and criteria. We combine that with clinical advice, local intelligence about the state of the epidemic, and of course judgment to construct a full, reliable and robust picture of the threat that COVID is posing across all of the four harms. We continue to monitor cases, obviously, but the number of hospital admissions, length of stay and deaths. And as and when, as I hope is the case, we become increasingly confident that vaccinations are breaking the link between case numbers and serious illness, then while we will not ignore case numbers, then the balance of factors that we take into account can change, and we can perhaps, as I've said before, be less driven in our response purely by, or not purely because we're not driven purely, but by so much by case numbers. But we've got to do this carefully and we've got to allow the data to emerge so that we can properly assess it and not act prematurely in a way that would cause a significant burden of ill health and pressure on the NHS.
Martin Whitfield to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given that there can't be a commitment to vaccinate in schools by the end of the summer holidays, when can schools and education authorities expect amended COVID advice with regards to the safety in school, wearing of masks, bubbles, distancing, and particularly probably school transport, given the rising infection rates that are linked to the schools?
First Minister.
The Advisory Group on Education, which is a subgroup of the overall COVID Scottish Government Advisory Group, looks at these issues on an ongoing basis, and it's important that it does so and gives its views to ministers, and ministers through the Education Recovery Group have reached positions on the mitigations that require to be in place. I think all of us want to see mitigations like face coverings no longer be necessary, and I think that is particularly true when we're talking about young people in school. But right now, it is important that that is there as an added mitigation, and we continue to review that as the situation overall and our understanding of the new variant and the wider impact of vaccines develop.
Emma Harper to be followed by Finlay Carson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government is rightly committed to ensuring cancer screening and diagnostic services are prioritised as we continue to remobilise the Scottish NHS as we recover from COVID. Cervical cancer self-tests are being trialled in some health boards, including NHS D&G, and they have a potential to be an effective way for women to screen for HPV. And with 6,000 women in NHS D&G missing appointments, self-tests also have been proven to reduce the number of women who default on their appointments. Can the First Minister therefore outline how cancer diagnostic services will be prioritised, and in particular, can she provide an update on the cervical cancer self-test rollout?
First Minister.
Well, self-sampling does have significant potential to increase the take-up of screening, and also, I think, to make it easier for those, and that's many, who find the current process difficult. That said, the UK National Screening Committee is gathering evidence on the matter and hasn't yet recommended that self-sampling should be incorporated into the National Cervical Screening Programme. We've convened a working group to explore the feasibility and requirements of different self-sampling models, which will contribute to the evidence base, and that group brings together clinical and public health expertise, including representatives from the Dumfries and Galloway study. Introducing self-sampling to the National Cervical Screening Programme will not be an insignificant undertaking, but we are working hard to ensure that Scotland is well placed to implement any National Screening Committee recommendations when we have them.
Finlay Carson to be followed by Gillian Martin.
First Minister, I'm sure you're aware of the significant backlog in people waiting to sit both the practical and theory driving tests. In my own constituency of Galloway and West Dumfries, poor or non-existent public transport make it imperative that young people obtain their driver licence quickly to allow them to get to work. And there are genuine concerns for businesses this summer, particularly those in hospitality and agriculture who are struggling right now to find employees. I've contacted DVSA, who state that capacity at most theory sites in Scotland is still at 50% as a result of the Scottish Government's 2-metre physical distancing restrictions, despite the exam conditions. Will the First Minister look to relax the rule in order that DVSA can increase testing capacity and ease the plight of many learner drivers and do what she can do to address the long delays in sitting both theory and practical driving tests?
First Minister.
I know how important this is, and I know how frustrating it is that there's obviously an economic imperative to have people able to sit driving tests, but it's one of the rites of passage for young people that have been disrupted over the past year or more, and obviously it's really important for them that we get this back on track. These issues and all of these issues are complex, and they are unfortunately really straightforward. 2-metre physical distancing in certain environments remains a really important mitigation. But yes, this is an important issue. So we are and will continue to look at this to see how quickly we can increase the capacity and get these backlogs down as quickly as possible. So I absolutely understand the importance of this, and I'll make sure that the Transport Minister keeps members updated.
Gillian Martin to be followed by Stephen Kerr.
Thank you. The pandemic has had a significant impact on young people, particularly on their chances of employment. The First Minister has appointed a minister who is specifically tasked with supporting youth employment. Can the First Minister provide any further information about steps the Scottish Government has taken to support young people to access employment and training?
First Minister.
Well, the Young Persons Guarantee is obviously central to those efforts, and I think will be increasingly important as we go through the next few years and through, hopefully, recovery from COVID. We will also continue to work very closely with local authorities and with schools to minimise any ongoing disruption to children's education and their ability to go on from school to further higher education or into training and employment. Obviously, one of the key things we're doing right now is working to get people vaccinated, including the younger groups in the population. That is going extremely well. But as we come out of this pandemic, there's no doubt that as part of the overall recovery, and actually the previous question relating to driving tests is only one aspect of this, but an important aspect of this, I think we need to prioritise recovery from young people who have borne so much of the brunt of what we've all gone through over the past year.
I call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Elena Witham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Hundreds of thousands of my constituents are living under level 2 restrictions with no indication of when they will move to level 1. The councils currently in level 1 know that they may move to level 0 provisionally on the 28th. My question is, when will the Scottish Government set out revised planning for when the 14 councils affected will move to levels 1 and 0?
First Minister.
Perhaps Stephen Kerr just took a bit more time to kind of understand the situation here. He would know that what he's just said there is not really accurate at all. The next review of all of the levels of protection happens on the 21st of June. Of course, there may be circumstances that require us to move more quickly than that, but I hope not. So on the 21st of June, I will set out for every area of the country what we expect the level of protection to be from the 28th of June. And that covers those in level 1, which we hope can go to level 0, but also those currently in level 2, which we would hope would go to level 1. But we need to assess the data nearer the time. That is the 3-weekly review cycle that we have committed to, and that's what we will continue. But you know, I wish I could wave a magic wand and get every area of the country, not just into level 0, but beyond level 0. But we have to do this carefully, and we have to do this in a way that protects our progress and, of course, allows us to get as many people as possible vaccinated.
I call Elena Witham to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In light of the recent news that Portugal has now been placed on the Amber List, taking effect today, it is clear that international travel for holiday purposes remains risky and subject to sudden change. Can I ask the First Minister what steps the Scottish Government is taking to support our local tourism industry, particularly as many people are choosing to holiday at home this year?
First Minister.
Well, I mean, first of all, before I address that question, can I just make a point of recognising, because I know that people who listen and hear us talk about international travel often in the context of holidays, but people who have family overseas and for whom international travel is about family connection often feel frustrated at that. So I recognise that for many people, the restrictions on international travel are keeping them away from their loved ones, and that's why we want to get back to normal there, as in every other aspect of life, as quickly as possible. For non-essential travel, for holidays, my advice continues to be don't go overseas if you can avoid doing that, because it is safer right now for us not to do that. It helps mitigate against the importation of the virus. And if you are in the position of being able to go a holiday this year, support local the local tourism industry. We discuss these matters regularly. I have reasonably regular discussions myself with the Scottish Tourism Alliance about how we better support the tourism industry in the immediate term, but also as it recovers in the medium to long term as well. But I think a message all of us could helpfully convey to our constituents right now is where you can support your local tourism industry, support the Scottish tourist industry, and indeed support local businesses generally as much as you're able to.
Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Finally, after weeks of asking, NHS Lothian have announced an hour ago that from next week, walk-in vaccination clinics will be available to those over 40. That is very welcome. The Cabinet Secretary for Health told me last week that Edinburgh is now the new Glasgow in terms of infection rate. Well, if that's the case, why do we still not have access to the door-to-door surge testing that has been available for weeks in areas like G41? Why are Edinburgh residents not as deserving of COVID protections as Glasgow residents?
First Minister.
Well, that's just complete nonsense, if I may say so. And I really do, I would urge everybody, by all means, rigorously hold me and my government to account. That is absolutely essential. But avoid things like Edinburgh's the new Glasgow or Edinburgh's not as deserving of measures as Glasgow. That kind of attempt to divide and set people against each other or suggest that we are not taking this pandemic seriously in every part of the country, I just don't think helps anybody. The local director of public health in Lothian with the local incident management team will be working to decide on based on the nature of the outbreak across Lothian what the appropriate measures are. Surge testing will be a part of that. If they consider that necessary and essential, then door-to-door testing will be a part of that. Walk-in vaccination clinics. I don't, and it may surprise people to hear this, I don't mandate to local public health directors exactly what they do in local outbreaks, because that would be wrong for me to do so. It is them that understand the nature of outbreaks and from the range of tools that they have available, what works best in local circumstances. So what I would say genuinely to all local members is engage, as I'm sure members do, with their local health boards, with their local director of public health, to understand the measures that are being put in place locally, which will be bespoke to the particular challenges that are facing. But please, all of us, just avoid this, you know, suggestion that one part of the country has been done down in favour of another part of the country. That's not true. We are all in this together and we're trying to get through it together.
And Brian Whittle.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I've been asked to raise a very specific issue around the European Under-20, Under-23 Athletics Championships, which take place this year. The trials for the Great Britain team take place on the 19th and 20th of this month in Bedford. Under the current legislation, Scottish legislation, it is illegal for Scottish athletes to travel to Bedford, which therefore means that there will be no Scottish representation at those championships. I wonder if the First Minister would look at this with a degree of urgency, given that each athlete has to have had a negative test prior to competing in those trials.
First Minister.
I would like to have the opportunity to look at that in detail before trying to answer it in detail. I'll come back to Brian Whittle as quickly as possible. Of course, when there are travel restrictions in place, there are exemptions for essential travel. And one of the things I need to check is whether athletes would fall into the category of travel that was permissible. If that's not the case, I'm happy to ask for that to be looked at to make sure that they can do what is required to compete as everybody would want them to do.
Thank you. There'll be a brief pause while the chair changes. Thank you.